My God, man. Do you know what this means? This ghetto's gonna be turned upside down, I tell you, upside down. If you get on his bad side, brother, you're done for. Now, it's only a matter of time before he finds out, and when he does, no matter where he is, get ready, gentlemen, because hell's a-coming. Hell's a-coming. Hell's a-coming. Hell's a-coming.
Tough mission, but I think you're ready.
If we're going to save the colonies, we're going to need top Gundam pilots. The transforming wing Gundam is the most powerful Gundam in the galaxy. But before you can unleash its full potential, you have to transform it from mobile suit mode to bird mode. That's why we need pilots with an ability to take on Gundam mechanics. Beat the best, you have to be the best.
Hello, everyone. I'm David Kaye, a.k.a. the voice of Professor X from that old series, X-Men Evolution. And you're listening to Gundam at MAHQ. Logan? Logan, where is Storm? Tell her to come for tea.
How has this become about a Gorn wedding? What are you avoiding?
Look, I'm just telling you the events of Stardate 57791.1, all right?
Gundam! Rude! I want details on how you stole the bird of prey!
I know, man! Me too!
All right, everybody, welcome back to Gundam at MAHQ. This is one of your hosts, Neo, and joining me always is the Soul Bro and the Chris. Guys, say hello.
Live long and prosper, baby!
Oh! He laid it down, Chris.
There you go. So say we all.
live fast and get fucked or whatever.
Right. I'm just going to say, I take life 1/4 mile at a time. 1/4 mile at a time, baby. Yes, you are listening to episode 274. 274, Gundam HQ. And we are going to be doing our review of season 3, the final season of Star Trek Picard. Oh my God, I know you've... Man, everybody's heard about it. Everybody's watched it. Everybody's got their own opinions. And you'll hear ours. So, guys, anything as I saunter over to the Larry King Memorial News Studio for some Neo's Listener Spinning News? Anything, Chris? Any updates on MHQ.com?
That we can... Well, I don't know about MHQ.com.
Oh,
I never...
.net. Sorry.
Got him.
Actually, the update on MHQ.com is that the Michigan Association for Healthcare Quality got to renew their domain
a couple
years ago, and some dude scooped it up, and he emailed me like, "Hey, you want to buy this for me?"
And how much you ask?
I was like, "Yeah, how much you want for it?" And this guy wanted like thousands, like $5,000.
Jesus,
I was like,
really?
No thanks, like. You wanted a
I've been done that for how many years? How many decades?
Fucking 20 years. Yeah. If it was like, you know, $500, even maybe up to $1,000, I might have bit. But like, this guy was just being too greedy, And there's literally no market for this name other than me. So rather than make some money, he tried to be greedy and ended up with nothing. And it's still sitting there unregistered. So
wow.
He must think he did he like misread like news or something? Did he think like you like Gundam like signed a deal with Spotify or you know like MHQ.net's got some like weird arrangement where they just get, you know, millions of dollars of
yeah, he must have thought that I was loaded it, like
that I was loaded come from in. A different multiverse.
Yeah, I don't know. But over on MHQ.net, check out, there's a new Chaos Theater Redux blog post, one I'm particularly proud of. This is a dual post, both me and Pedro giving our thoughts on the legacy of Kevin Conroy.
Oh, wow. Oh,
I saw that post on the Bird app. Yeah, I saw that.
Yeah, I saw the link for this, and I thought you guys had reposted the episode, but man, look at this. Holy shit. For Pedro, for me, there's only been ever one Batman. God damn. He'd be correct. Man. He'd be correct. That's not even up for debate. It's not even a,
yeah.
Man, it's Michael Keaton. Get the fuck out of here. The next two words out your mouth ain't Kevin Conroy. I don't want to hear you. That's it. But yeah, man, this is freaking cool, man. So MHQ.net, guys, if you guys don't have never been, please visit. All you have to do is go there and make it one of your favorites and check it out on a daily basis. So and make sure to check out those ads. Bring in the revenue, goddammit. But there's a lot of great content on the website that you guys should definitely check out. Well, whether it be articles like this.
That's how you can afford all those web addresses.
Hey, man, there you go.
yeah, that's how the magic happens.
Yeah, exactly. That's
how the magic happens.
Monetization. That's the magic.
I will also note, between last episode and this, I did a guest appearance again with our friends over at Mechanista NG.
That's right.
So we had a good conversation. The episode is not out yet at the time of this live stream, so I will not spoil what the topic was of the mobile suit that we rolled, but it's a good one. So go check that out when they drop it.
Awesome.
Nice.
Should be pretty soon.
Shout out to those cats. If you guys want to check out their podcast, head on over to MHQ.net and click on the podcast category, and you'll be able to find their latest work right there. So when the episode's up, you guys will be notified. Also follow us over on, whether it be on Twitter or over on... what the fuck? Mastodon.
God,
Mastodon. A new one just opened up today or this week called, what's it called?
Blue Sky.
Blue Sky, yeah, from Jack.
It's not new.
Yeah. What's that all about?
It's
not,
it's a social media network, much like Twitter, actually founded by...
Created by Jack Dorsey.
By Jack Dorsey, who, of course,
created Twitter for those.
Given that everything went so well for him on... on Twitter,
yeah,
surely.
Yeah, exactly.
Surely, everything will go just fine on
Blue Sky, right?
On Blue Sky, yeah, because he did such a good job before.
To get on, you actually have to download the app, and then get in a waiting line, and you'll get a letter when it's your time to be able to get in. But it's that's not gonna be not much of a social media network if people can't openly join. So. Maybe they'll change that.
Well, they're also they're doing invites, so you can get invites from people, which of course, you know, some clowns are selling for money. It's like,
of course.
Oh my god. Pathetic.
Oh, jeez.
Utterly pathetic.
I guess the thing that really, you know, shocks everybody is the fact that you know, the Bird app is still around. At this point, because I mean,
not for lack of trying on Elon's part to destroy it.
Yeah.
Jesus Christ!
The fiasco that he's caused is just
my god,
such a magnificent level of incompetence that it's like I didn't know anyone could be this stupid, and we've lived through how many years of Donald Trump,
right?
And counting.
Yeah, just to see the comedy that that spawned from people not taking the blue check but being given it anyway, and then having to refute
giving it to to Kobe Bryant and Chadwick Boseman,
yeah,
and
right,
Anthony Bourdain. Like, yeah, these guys verified their phone numbers from where?
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, fuck, exactly. It's like, what's the point of a verification check if it doesn't help to prove that the person is the person? People come to these social media networks to be able to interact with people that they would not be able to interact with in the street, and you want some kind of, some actual legitimate verifier in order to be able to do, be able to interact with these people. Otherwise, what's the draw? I mean, you can get in there and talk to your friends, which is what I do. I don't go in there to talk to celebrities for the most part, but you know, a lot of people get on there just to have an interaction with them, and you know, a lot of people walk away with that experience, and now anybody can buy that that check, and it holds no value now. Only value it holds is $8.99, and I'm not spending a fucking cent on it.
I'm still confused by it, because he reinstated it for certain people.
Yeah.
And he didn't reinstate it for others. Yeah. Like, I don't get it. Like, I have Sirius Radio, and I was listening to Howard Stern, and he's been making a big joke about it. He's like, yeah, for some reason I got my blue check back. Like, he's like, because he doesn't even do his Twitter. Like, he's like, well, I've been verified. But it's really stupid.
Anybody who has over a million followers was given it back, whether they actually
deserved it or not.
Whether they actually want it or not.
Oh, okay. Ugh. Yeah, it's crazy. I sat there and I was like, I don't know. It's America's it's a great country, because, Musk sat there was like, I was never given anything from my family. We didn't have a emerald mind or anything. And his father's bullshit. Like, yeah, we did.
How do
we
you did. Think can you I, can word? I, can I get the Dogecoin?
Like, how do you think you got everything that you have already? So it's like, it's crazy. So.
Oh God.
Like, oh daddy, that Dogecoin ain't going to be worth it can be worth much in a couple of months.
Exactly.
Worth hay pennies.
Oh. and by the way, folks, I just want to let you know that cryptocurrency is not currency, it's a security. Anything that you have to sit there and buy and wait to see what the value is going to be at the end of the day, that's a security. It's not currency. So,
hey, man. Well, what?
Just, that's financial advice that you won't get from Jim Cramer, because he'll tell you to buy, buy, buy.
But isn't SBF your man's?
Fuck no. Well, go to YouTube and see Jim Cramer talk about SBF.
You're right. He talked him up. He talked him up so hard. And then this shit all comes crashing down. And he's talking about, I warned you. Dude, I warned you about this guy. It's like, Jim Cramer, go fuck yourself. Again.
I will, and once again, I'm not a registered investment advisor, but I will tell everybody that's listening to this stream right now. If you ever want to invest in the stock market, the best thing to do is buy an index fund, an S&P index fund, electronically index fund. Do not listen to people like Jim Cramer. Jim Cramer said, I called them multiple times. I'm like, why the fuck are you throttling my internet? They're like, I don't know what you're talking about.
Oh, don't talk about your lying pieces of shit.
It's like, what the fuck? Oh, my God. Yeah. It's like, I'm doing the speed test right now. But, man, so, bro, we're talking about the Macross Frontier pop-up stage. It's going to be where you can actually sit there and have a song battle. So,
is that the first? Because I didn't get any of the news. At all. Oh, wow. Okay. So, only people who heard the news was you two then. the street didn't hear.
Oh, so we're doing the news ourselves?
Yeah, okay. The news. You were talking into a vacuum.
Okay.
Well, too bad, because we ain't going to do it again.
All right, well, fuck
it. No, we're not going. Yeah, right. I'm not going. Well,
hopefully, let's save the best stories for last. But go for it.
I just do what's in front of me. All right, you know that.
Right on. So you talked that long, didn't hear me say one word, and kept going.
Well, we didn't know what was going on. We just went with it. He'll be back. Well, it's like, he'll go in and out, and he'll be back. But
well, an apology to the stream, just to let the stream know, my internet went down. I had to reboot my modem. I did record the audio for the time except I was down. I was actually talking up the time while the internet was down. So I will put up the the completed version just to get it out there for you guys.
You did not get my intro about the Macross Frontier.
None of that. I got none of it.
The 3D CG live concert.
We are wrapping up our talk about MHQ, and I said, "Hey, how about the news, man? We got lots of news to cover." And then my internet cut out, and that was the end of that.
Hear you say that?
Oh wow!
We didn't even hear you say that.
Sweet. Oh my god. Well, please continue. Continue where you left off.
Okay, so yeah, it's we're not going back to the old news. So yeah, there's going to be a Macross Frontier 3D CG event coming this summer, and it's going to be great. You're going to be seeing Cheryl, you're going to see Ronka, and they're going to be doing battles, and it's going to be awesome. And it's going to be a celebration of Macross, and it's the article here says in Crunchyroll.com, it says this is Macross Frontier's first 3D CG live show in its 41-year history.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, pretty much, because this is probably what recent technology. There you go. So thank you, MCT Dread, for that submission. Oh, man. Oh, this is actually kind of interesting. MCT Dread comes back. It looks like, you know, that big life-size moving Gundam there in Japan?
Yeah, yeah.
It learned how to do rock, paper, scissors.
Oh, so, wow.
Yeah, that's cool. I don't... Will that be in a new episode? Maybe of Witch from Mercury? That might work. Is that going to be their answer to the Time Bomb episode of...
The Time Bomb episode!
Solbro's favorite episode. They're gonna do it. This guy is great. He's taking all the bombs off that we set up there. Oh, I know he's our enemy, but you know, it's great just to watch him sit there and take the things that we were supposed to blow him up with. But you know, so yeah, the life-size moving RX-78-2 at Gundam Factory Yokohama has picked up some new tricks. It's now capable of performing all the movements required to play rock, paper, scissors. So. That's pretty awesome. Guys, how do you feel about that?
That sounds pretty cool. If anything, it's a pretty cool feature for it. I'm sure it delights people who actually go to visit the suit and then to see.
You don't have to lie.
No, man, I like that. It's an interactive thing. Like, if you're standing in front of it and you want to play rock, paper, scissors with it and it's that time of day. I think it's really cool, man. Shout outs to Ed. Ed says, if you think about it, the aerial used paper in episode 12. Woo! Yo, goddamn. Yo. Yo, good shit, Ed. I see you.
Ed, what are you talking about?
Man. Who knows?
Go. All right. So. You guys ready for the last article of the night? Oh, it's some dead guy news.
Oh, man.
It's coming from the shade. I know both you and Soul. I think Chris is probably really hurt by this. Mm-hmm. Harmony Gold founder Frank Agarama had passed away.
Mm-hmm.
Chris, you okay with this? I mean...
No comento.
He was 93. He passed away peacefully at his home with his family at his side. And, yeah, there's going to be a small service. He was born in 1930 in Egypt, and he studied medicine and surgery. And he used those skills to basically rip apart Macross.
Oh, shit.
Is that too soon? No. I'm just going by his little bio here.
Mm-hmm.
He founded Harmony Gold in 1983. Also, bro. You were probably just a little kid at that point, weren't you?
I was 83. I was what, 6?
Well, there you go. You were a little shit.
There you go. Indeed.
Little jit. You were a jit.
I was a jit, huh?
You were a jit.
Is that what I was? Jitterbug status? I see you. All right.
Go. He founded Harmony Gold at the time. He was chairman and CEO. He handled the company handled the production, acquisition, and distribution of international TV programming. He's the executive producer of the 1985 Robotech (parentheses Macross anime) and all its sequel attempts. through Harmony Gold, he also served as executive producer as the English dubs for Dragon Ball, space pirate Captain Harlock in Once Upon a Time anime. Mm-hmm. He's also credited as one of his two screenplay writers of Robotech The Shadow Chronicles. Oh, man. Oh, he was part of that?
He wrote the screenwriter for that?
Yes. Wow, he got the credit.
That explains a lot.
Come on. You really think that this guy wrote a single thing?
All he wrote was his name on the script. That's it.
he didn't write shit.
That's it.
Don't kid yourself.
In the beginning of 2006, it's oddly case, which revolved around the numerous non-Robotech-related Paramount properties that Argamo resold to Berlusconi's media company, Finvest. He acted as a middleman, reselling Paramount properties to those companies for broadcast in Italy.
Mm-hmm.
He's found guilty of tax fraud in 2012. That's awesome.
Boy, was he.
Yeah. Yeah, he's a true American businessman. You really can't be a true American businessman unless you're convicted of tax fraud. And he did not serve his 3 years though in prison due to amnesty law. So, yeah, that's a sad thing that he died. I mean, Chris, do you want to just talk about how he impacted your life? Probably for the better, right?
No comento.
No comento. So, bro. He gave you Robotech.
Wow. I'm not going to speak ill of the dead. I won't do that. I will say that I appreciate the impact that Robotech had on my life as a youngster. I don't appreciate the impact that Harmony Gold had on the Macross franchise as an adult, or even throughout its whole course of its run. He was a big part of that, but you know what? He lived a long life. He did the things he wanted to do. He's got an answer to whoever now, and I wish his family peace and healing in this time. So there you go.
So what do you think, guys? What do you think? Before we move on, is God a Macross or a Robotech fan? Is he Valkyries or Veritex? What do you think?
I'm sure.
So, bro.
I'm going to say Macross because he knows what's right. He knows.
Okay. Chris.
No comento.
No comment. There you go. There you go.
See, Chris is smart.
Holds firm. Holding firm. Good shit. Good shit. I respect.
You're going to catch me in no lawsuits.
Chris has got... He's got a website.
My affidavit's already on the way.
There you go. You're already getting sued, so bro.
Ducking processes everywhere I go. Like, hey man, do I know you? I was like, no, motherfucker, you don't know me. I'm out.
I'm like, it's served. Don't answer that knock at the door.
Yeah, I'm like, it's served. No way. Fuck that.
So, yes, that's the news. And thank you everybody for submitting news. If you ever have any news articles, always go to the news listeners to the news articles thread in the goddamn section on the Mecha Talk forum.
Mm-hmm.
And we're gonna go into our first and only topic of the night, season 3, the final season of Star Trek Picard. So
exciting times, man. Yo, God is more of a Mospita fan. Ed writes, there you go, amen. Ed, you know what time it is. That's the talk.
So Chris, you want to give us a quick summary of season 3?
Quick summary, maybe not, but I will say that this is going to be entirely spoiler-filled, so if you have not watched season 3, then you should stop listening right now, because I'm going to spoil the whole fucking thing.
Yeah.
So, season 3 of Picard picks up not too long after season 2, and he hears a strange chirping from one of his old Enterprise DCOM badges, and there's an encoded signal on it from Beverly Crusher, who he has not spoken to for 20 years. So he gets Will Riker's help to try to decode the message. And the message is that she's in trouble and tells him to trust no one, because apparently she's been hanging out with Fox Mulder somehow in the future.
Indeed.
So they need to get to this remote star system outside of Federation space, and Riker comes up with a plan to bamboozle the captain of the Titan A by tricking him into thinking that they're doing an inspection ahead of Frontier Day. So Picard and Riker meet with Captain Liam Shaw and his first officer, Seven of Nine, and Shaw gives birth to a new meme by saying no. But Seven takes them anyway, and they steal a shuttle, meet up with Beverly and some mysterious young Englishman. She's in a medical pod. They're attacked by a giant ship that looks like two Cylon Raiders taped together. And said ship comes after the Titan, and its maniacal captain, Vadic, demands that they hand Jack Crusher over, who, surprise of surprises, is Picard's secret son. And they want him for some unknown reason, and there's a cat and mouse game in this strange nebula where they're trying to hide from Shrike and discover that they have a portal weapon that can turn photon torpedoes back on you, and it's a big old thing. But they manage to figure out a way to escape said nebula, which actually turns out to be a big old birthing pod for those space jellyfish that we've seen here and there on the next gen pilot and in Lower Decks.
Yep.
And then we have another storyline where Raffi is working undercover and having to take drugs, and she's investigating this conspiracy of this theft from the Daystrom Institute, and sees this terrorist attack where the same portal weapon is used to prop up a portal underneath a Starfleet building and then have it all fall in there, and then have a portal open up above that and just dump it there and kill a bunch of people.
Mm-hmm.
She tries to investigate more against her handler's orders and gets herself in trouble. And said handler has to rescue her and turns out to be one Mr. Worf.
Woohoo!
So the Titan makes contact with another Federation ship, the Intrepid, to hand over Picard and Riker for having, stolen a ship and committed various crimes. And they're met by Rolaren, of all people, who is somehow back in Starfleet and is a commander. And Picard's like, yo, what the fuck? And she works out her issues with him about her betrayal to join the Maquis, and tells him that there's a big old changeling infiltration of Starfleet up to the top, and everybody's compromised, and something big is going on with Frontier Day, which is a gathering of all of Starfleet at Earth to celebrate the 250th anniversary of Jonathan Archer's Enterprise NX-01. So some changeling shenanigans happen, and Ro unfortunately sacrifices herself to let the Titan get away, and they end up going to the Fleet Museum, which is run by Commodore Geordi LaForge, and we go on a little nostalgia tour seeing a bunch of famous ships at said museum, like Archer's Enterprise NX-01, there's the Enterprise A, the Excelsior, the HMS Bounty from the one with the whales, and some obscure ships called Voyager and Defiance, and something secret in Hangar 12. So Geordi is like, hey, I got kids now. I can't be running around doing this stuff with y'all. And they want to go back to the Daystrom station to investigate the theft and figure out what it is that these changelings are up to. And they end up stealing the cloaking device from the HMS Bounty to give the Titan a cloak. They go to the Daystrom station, and Riker and Worf over there with Raffi and ran into old Moriarty, and they discover a bunch of interesting things there that it's basically like the Section 31 storage closet with Genesis 2. That's something that's there.
Mm-hmm.
You have a genetically modified attack tribble. have the body of James T. Kirk for some mysterious reason.
Yeah.
You also have the body of the human body of Jean-Luc Picard for another mysterious reason. And unfortunately, Riker gets captured by changelings, and they end up making off with the security system running Daystrom Station, which is actually a new golem that has been made to look like Data and contains in it the memories of Data, Lore, Before, and Lol. So there's this battle going on between Data and Lore across a couple of episodes, and finally Data is able to take control and subsume Lore within him, and he's back. But you know, this is the backup of himself that he made into Before in Nemesis, so you know, he's not up to speed exactly on the current events. They end up having to fight the Shrike again, and Vadic ends up boarding the ship. We discover that Jack has the ability to go into people's heads and control them, and he does this on one of Geordi's daughters, and it's very weird and creepy.
Very.
And what they finally determine is that the changelings are working with a Borg, not to the confusion of every clown who didn't pay attention, the Borgati of Agnes Girardi. Not those people, not the nice, friendly Borg collective, but the bad old Borg, well, the cooperative. This is the bad old collective under the same old queen, voiced by Alice Krieg, that we've been seeing on and on again, still causing problems. And what they learn is that Borg and the changelings have removed pieces of Picard's brain, and you know, he retained some Borg stuff in him from his time as Locutus, which we already knew from the fact that if you watch First Contact, he can still hear Borg talking in his head.
Absolutely.
And he unfortunately passed that on to old Jack Crusher in that Picard DNA. And it turns out that Picard never had Irrimadic syndrome that he was diagnosed with. It was actually lingering effects of Borg stuff that actually killed him.
Yeah.
Which is an interesting way to reframe everything that happened in season one.
Very much so.
And Jack, you know, he hears the Queen calling out to him because Deanna Troi tried to, like, go in his head and help him figure out what's behind the red door, and was there was a Borg cube, and he decides that he's gonna go, you know, just face her and deal with the problem. And instead she assimilates him and turns him into Mox, sort of the new Locutus of the Borg. And you know, her plan is to use him to take control of Starfleet, because as our intrepid old Enterprise crew figures out, the Borg's plan is that they took Picard's altered DNA that they got out of his brain, and they have used that to override the common DNA that's stored in transporters to help with materializing people. And they've been pumping people with Borg shit up whenever they use the transporters. So because of you know, the way the brain develops and yada yada, everybody under the age of 25 has used a transporter, has already been pre-primed for assimilation.
Yep.
And Vox will be the trigger on Frontier Day. So unfortunately for them, Starfleet, still have not learned the lesson about network ships, have this thing called fleet formation, which allows the entire fleet to operate in unison, and you really can't, you know, go and fight With the Titan, they try, but it gets sucked into fleet formation mode. So the TNG crew, they escape in a shuttle, and Geordi's like, hey, why don't we go back to the Fleet Museum? And he takes them inside Hangar 12, which, lo and behold, has the restored Enterprise D, which they're all shocked to see. He explains that he's been slowly restoring it for 20 years, like, you know, a middle-aged dad restoring a muscle car on the weekends in his garage.
Yeah, but it's not all the D, though. Like, part
not
of it's,
quite. The Star Drive comes from another Galaxy-class ship that he got, and they head off on one last mission with the old Enterprise D, and they go to fight the Borg, and this ginormous cube is in Jupiter in the big red spot. So they go in and do some crazy flying, with, you know, the Enterprise D looking absolutely tiny compared to this gigantic cube. Mm-hmm. And Picard has to face his fears and reconnect himself to the collective to reach Jack and tell him that you know, this is not the way, and you're not alone, and you don't have to do this. And Jack rejects the Borg, and they blow up the Queen one more time and manage to get out. And we get an epilogue a year later. We find out that Beverly has come back to Starfleet, and she has been promoted to Admiral, and she's been put in charge of Starfleet Medical, and came up with a way to use the transporter to de-Borgify everyone and to also suss out the remaining changeling infiltrators. Seven of Nine gets promoted to captain. Everybody gets cleared of all of the crimes they committed. Mm-hmm. The old Enterprise D gets put back into storage, but this time now on display at the Fleet Museum with, you know, a new victory under its belt.
Oh, yeah.
Jack Crusher gets fast-tracked through the Academy because of nepotism, and he gets assigned under Seven as an ensign. And we find out that in recognition of the heroic efforts of the Enterprise crew, that the Titan A has been rechristened as the Enterprise G, because we did briefly see the Enterprise F during Frontier Day, captained by Admiral Elizabeth Shelby, who got blasted a minute of coming on screen.
God damn.
And the old Enterprise F was slated for early decommissioning because its systems were compromised, according to an Instagram post. And, you know, to the surprise of nobody, it was the Star Trek Online design. So that's been made officially canon now.
Awesome.
So the Titan A becomes the Enterprise G, and Seven sets off on her new adventures with her new crew. And at the end of the day, the old Enterprise D crew gathers at the 10 Forward bar on Earth to play one last game of poker. Man. And then young lad Jack gets a mysterious visitor who is none other than Q, who of course died in season 2. And Q's like, oh man, don't be so linear. Like, you know, your trial is just beginning. The end. Credits.
Bye.
Well said, man. Well said. Well done. Good shit. Well, who's going first?
Is Chris there? Yeah. Chris, who do you want to go first?
I guess since I've been talking so much.
I'll go first. It's cool.
Bro. Yeah, you go, because
let me gush.
We're waiting because the nostalgia train's been going.
Well, let me put this on the table. This wasn't a perfect season, But man, ooh, man, it was what the doctor ordered. Let me just put that on the table.
Which doctor?
What doctor is it?
Dr. Zimmerman.
Dr. Pulaski?
Yo, Dr. Pulaski, man, who has a ship named after her, which means she's probably dead. I hate to be the one to point that out, but it's like...
Well,
not necessarily, but, you know, what does she do to deserve having a ship named after her?
I don't know. Exactly. You know what? Looking back on Dr. Pulaski, because I watched season two recently, I don't hate Dr. Pulaski at all. I didn't like her when she first rolled around, because she seemed like too much like Bones, and a bunch of other things you could complain about. But in retrospect, I actually like her a lot. And I know that there was on-set things that went on between... Diana Muldaur and the rest of the cast, and also she was kind of like forced on them by people who were running the show at the time, but
which is neither here nor there, so.
Yeah, but either way, it was cool to see a ship named after her, and you know what, I kind of wish she had at least a cameo in this, but it's nothing I'm not gonna lose sleep over. Anyway though, this season I knew going in, hearing the hype from all sorts of people behind the scenes, especially people who hated seasons 1 and 2 of Picard, that this season made up for it. I believed them, but at the same time, it's like, it can't be that good. It can't be. I sit down and watch this, and the first 4 episodes, it's kind of like its own arc. I call it the Titan arc. And basically, the crew of the Titans thrown in the situation because of Picard and Riker trying to go out there and rescue Beverly, not knowing that his son was also waiting in the wings. And to see how all that chaos comes together and how it's written all together, they did a really good job of like putting the characters in the situation and then having them on the run from the Shrike and of course Vadic and her crew. And the slow drip of finding out everything in this series was an absolute joy to see unfold. Like I love an unfolding mystery when done right, and Terry and his writing staff, they really put this all together. There are things you can nitpick about, and I'm sure we'll get into them, but for the most part, man, I really enjoyed the unfolding for this. I would say that one of the, and it's a nitpick really, but it's not so much an issue for me because we kind of built up to this anyway, being that this is kind of a reunion season, that there are a lot of callbacks to movies and TV shows, especially in the Star Trek universe, but also from other things too.
Wrath of Khan.
Yeah, Wrath of Khan gets sourced a lot. And on top of that, Undiscovered...
It's the basis.
Undiscovered Country gets sourced too, because you go and you cast Amanda...
movie none of them are part of, but okay.
No, Amanda Plummer is the daughter of Christopher Plummer. They casted her in this to have that vibe. God. It's true. I don't know if you know that, but it's true.
60 degrees of separation here.
No, all right. It's what they said. So you know. But yeah, they casted her so that way she'd kind of have the same kind of presence. This whole season's about deja vu, in a sense. You're going to be reminded of a lot of things that made Star Trek great, especially The Next Generation. But it also pulls from other shows, like Voyager, when you have the end of a long story arc with Seven of Nine, and seeing her character develop and evolve. What's that?
Oh, no, that's Deep Space Nine.
Although you get little touches of Deep Space Nine as well, with the Changelings' involvement and mention of the Dominion War. And, of course, Worf, whose character was very developed in Deep Space Nine, he's come a long way, too. He's probably the most developed character in all of Star Trek, to be quite honest with you. No, maybe Spock. Spock and then Worf. And then you might say 709 at this point, because she's come a long way, too. It's been over 20 years since her character was introduced. So to see her and... the heights she rose to in this was really welcoming to see. Shout outs to Jeri Ryan. She's been fantastic in this whole series. And to see it culminate to this and to see her become the captain of the Enterprise was such a rewarding thing to watch, man.
Who knew that you didn't need to stick her into a cat suit to have her be appealing? Oh, wait. Literally anybody not named Rick Berman. That's
right. It's true. She had a hard time those seasons that she was on Voyager, and people thought she was just introduced into the show for a simple reason. But she got to evolve that character. She got to define that character. And then when we get reintroduced to her again in Picard, seasons 1 and 2, which you don't necessarily have to watch to enjoy this show. If you miss 1 and 2, I was telling people throughout the run of Picard that if you watch Next Generation, you haven't seen seasons 1 and 2, go watch a go watch a recap video if you want to get the details, but you can jump right into season three, really. You can get caught up. There might be a few things you might miss. You might miss how Raffi figures into the story, but I even think they did a good job of reintroducing her character, showing us that she has family issues and that she had a drug issue, and you know, some of the touchstones that we delved into season one and two, we got here. When it comes to 7 and 9 and Raffi, though, one of the things that did annoy me is that we didn't really get to see at least one good scene between those two characters having an interaction. You know, we had like little moments, but really they had broken up probably because Raffi was going on a mission, but I wanted kind of a bit more meat there, especially in their relationship. And it was something that people have been asking for, you know, to see more of their relationship throughout the series. I think we got the most of it in season two, but season three would have been nice to kind of see how that worked out. But I do enjoy the fact that they both ended up on the Enterprise in the end, of course, the first officer and the captain. But I did want to see more of them featured in the series. But I did enjoy what Raffi shared with Worf. You know, Worf and her had such a great dynamic, and even the actors, they loved working with each other. So I was glad to see that that all worked out and to see how their arc kicked off and eventually dovetailed into the Titan storyline, and them getting on the Titan, becoming part of the action there was great. That storyline also leads us to Ensign Ro and her grand return to the series. That episode was a heart-wrenching one, man, to be honest with you. I did not expect by any chance of the imagination that Michelle Forbes was going to come back and play this character. But to see her appear and to not have it ruined for me before watching the episode was a miracle into itself. But watching it, it's like, man, I can't believe you're here right now. But I got a sneaky suspicion they're going to kill you off. And lo and behold, they do.
They almost didn't.
They almost didn't? What do you know?
So they planned to have it. This was in the script, but they couldn't do this budget-wise.
Yeah.
That the changelings beamed her off of the shuttle at the last minute because they wanted to hold on to her to pump her for information. And then at the end of the show, she would have been found alive and rescued on the Intrepid.
Oh, wow. Man.
So you would have seen her again, but they couldn't swing it, so dead she is.
That sucks, man. Do you think they might have leave that thread for something later if we do get Star Trek Legacy?
I mean, you didn't see her die on screen, so yeah. They could always say that that's indeed what happened and just didn't show it.
That's true, man. A lot of times people don't stay dead in Star Trek. One of the characters I do hope that comes back is one of my favorite captains to ever appear in the history of Star Trek, and that's old Captain Shaw, man, named after the character, named after the actor Robert Shaw from Jaws, because his character is inspired by Quint from Jaws, apparently, which I thought was a cool comparison to the two, especially when he goes into his story about Wolf 359 in the 10 Forward mock-up. They got a lot of work out of 10 Forward, by the way, in this season. My God.
You know, since they filmed it literally days after they finished season two, they're really just continuing to make use of that set from season two.
Boy, the mileage. Boy, they got a ton. I wish they brought back Guinan, but that moment where Shaw relays the story about what happened at Wolf 359, I already guessed that he was involved with Wolf 359 from the first episode. Just how he treated 7 of 9, it's like he has to have some connection to that. I'm getting real episode one of Deep Space Nine Cisco vibes from this guy. And sure enough, in episode 5, they break it down, man. And that's a standout scene. Todd Stashwick, I've never been introduced to this actor before in anything. I hadn't watched 12 Monkeys yet and anything else that he'd been in. But I am now a fan. I enjoy that guy. He kind of has a Bill Murray vibe to him. And he even admitted so that he was it's basically Bill Murray as a space captain is who is who Shaw is, basically, in his delivery. And he's not lying. He is he calls himself a dipshit from Chicago. Well, Todd Stashwick is from Chicago, so that definitely tracks. But just to see his involvement in the story, especially in the beginning where we first meet him in the ready room or the dining hall, wherever the hell they were, and the fact that he just started to eat without them and just pays them no regard because he doesn't really care for them all that much. When it comes to Picard and Riker, and then gives them the later on gives them the bunk beds to sleep in. Shit was hilarious, man. This guy was comedy gold, man. And you know, he was actually a good captain. He was by the book, safe, and you know, didn't agree with the kind of the adventurous vibe of the rest of the Enterprise crew. But overall, he was a captain that cared about his crew and wanted to make sure that they didn't put him in any kind of unnecessary danger. But when the time arose for action to take place, he did participate. He did, you know, help everybody.
You have to mention not just that he didn't care for Picard and Riker. Mm-hmm. You have to mention who he did care for.
Yeah, that's true. And later on, he actually has a face-to-face with Geordi LaForge. And, of course, his origins in Starfleet is being an engineer. And meeting Geordi, he fanboyed out, and it was great. As you should when you meet Geordi LaForge. I love that scene, man. He bugged out, and it was like any of us meeting a cast member of this show. It was just like
that. Yeah, but I love the fact that he's like, oh, Picard and Riker, fucking...
Yeah, he don't give a fuck.
Guys, command, who gives a shit?
Yeah.
A fucking engineer? Oh,
that's the guy.
From God.
Yo, nerds, man. Stick together, man. Good shit. But yeah, that was a great scene, too. But, I know that one of my observations of this season, and just in Trek in general, is that there's been a little bit of repeating or reminiscent storylines between shows. And it makes me wonder if the creative staffs between these shows are actually talking to each other. There were elements dealing with the Kobayashi Maru throughout all these different series last year. And it's something that gets mentioned, but, you know, it like in 2022, it was like everywhere, the Kobayashi Maru. AI villains was also a big thing throughout the new Trek shows, such as Discovery with Control, I think that's what it was called. And then you have the Texas-class ships. And then you have this stupid idea that Shelby decided to come up with, who should have known better, to tie all these ships together on these automatic detection, you know, guidance programs. It's like, what are you thinking?
Don't forget the living construct from Prodigy.
Exactly, right? That's even a bigger thing. It makes me wonder if they're all talking to each other. And if they're not, they need
Well, apparently to. They do, and yet here we are.
Yeah, that to me is not good. I know that things are going to repeat when it comes to Star Trek. There's only so many things you can do. I get that. But this is kind of a big plot point, and a lot of people know that in sci-fi, AI usually doesn't work out well for humans, or mortals in general. And for that to be a big plot point here, it's something that Starfleet kind of should have, they should have done, is they should have kind of made that something they also snuck into the programming of the ships, as opposed to putting in it willingly. You know, kind of like how they put the Trojan horse for the transporter. Modifications of everybody, they put that in behind the scenes. I thought that was super clever, but willingly having all these ships work together like that, especially after what happens in Prodigy at the end of that season, yeah, that makes no sense to me. And that was only 20 years prior. So
actually, the problem that you have with that whole narrative is like you just go with Picard season one, about like. We're not going to have robots. We're going to have networking and stuff like that. It's like, why would you do this?
Yeah,
like,
go ahead. Sorry.
I get maybe the whole situation of like notifying if like, you know, we want a situation besides like if Earth gets in trouble, besides only the Enterprise can come and save us. We mm-hmm. want other ships to come save us, like an alerts thing. But the fact of where... It's like we're going to fully automate everything. It's really stupid.
Yeah, it's not a smart plan. Really stupid. And there's numerous things you can cite throughout the history of Trek that makes it a bad idea. Going all the way back to the original series. So like with Richard Daystrom and his supercomputer. You know, it's not a good idea unless you have like a lot of fail safes in order to get you out of that situation. Then you can give it a shot. But yeah, it just struck me as an odd plot point to go with that Starfleet would willingly elect to. So that to me was super wild. The last episode was a little bit of Return of the Jedi for me, but I was okay with it because I was all caught up in the hype and seeing Data fly throughout the Borg cube and them taking out the center of it and then making that grand escape. At that point, you're hanging on for dear life. But taking a step back to when they step onto the Enterprise D for the first time, I didn't think we were going to get the D, man, because I knew going into this season that the people behind the show said that there was a kind of a limited space on the sets they could use and the resources they had to do this season. But I think they, Chris, do you know if they built the set for the D at a different studio?
They did.
Yeah, they built it in Europe, right?
It's built in California.
Gotcha.
California. Yeah.
What a set time. And I know
it's rebuilt from the original specs.
Yeah. I know that the blueprints for the bridge of the Enterprise D had been lost or never even made. So they had to like build this thing from scratch.
Oh, well, they have blueprints. I don't know what you're talking
about. Yeah,
I don't know
what you're talking about that.
They
even have the thing about the cup holders that are supposed to be in the original, that they were originally supposed to have in Star Trek The Next Generation for this. So I don't know what you're talking about. Like everything was lost.
I saw an interview with Doug Drexler talking about he was asking for the blueprints for the Enterprise D bridge, and they didn't quite have everything that he was looking for. They may have had some blueprints, but there were certain things that were missing.
You're making it sound like they had nothing at all. And
my bad. I didn't mean to lead people on. I'm basically trying to.
I know where you get on that. It's like that part. Like, I guess you haven't been on social media where they've been like, oh, all the people that worked on this. It's like, oh, it was so great to be able to recreate this from all the stuff that we were able to see before.
Yeah, they had to watch every episode of the show to get all the angles of the bridge to recreate it.
No, they didn't have to.
They did. I can link you to a video where they talked about it.
There's blueprints. like Chris said, there's blueprints. They recreated every... I mean, you're making it sound like it was like this lost like thing that they would never... like. The lost blueprints of the Enterprise D will never be able to recreate this. They were able to do it very quickly.
I'll tell you what.
The issue that I saw about it was they spent all the money recreating it.
I will find
what and they didn't do a lot of other things.
I will find and transcribe the video that I saw, and then come back to y'all next episode. And I'll read verbatim whatever, because I'm sure I'm misconstruing some of that, but. If anything, they made.
I know you're misconstruing because I've read interviews with other people.
Yeah,
I'll feel you. Talked about consulting the blueprints. So.
I'm not afraid of being wrong. And if I'm wrong, I will eat. Yeah, I will eat crow. That's cool.
you're gonna eat.
You can
crow,
take my word on it that you're wrong. You don't have to go digging and transcribing.
Exactly. Hey, man, look. Yeah. Like even cool. I know that.
All right.
Like,
fair enough.
There is like, yeah, it's not the thing of like this shit was lost and nobody ever. And they're like painstakingly recreating it from like watching each season of Star Trek The Next Generation. They didn't have to do that.
Shout out to Jeff in the chat. He says it must have been the movie version of the D that wasn't available for Doug Drexler. That could be the case. I might have not heard everything clearly. So I'll take Chris's word for it and just go with that. I'll go with that. But yeah, I just know it was not an easy thing to recreate given a lot of factors involved.
It was just money. If you hear them talk about it, it's just the money. They had a limited, but they had a budget, and they spent a lot of the budget recreating the Enterprise. Because what's the bottle episode? Chris, you probably know what I'm talking about. There's an episode where it's basically the bottle. It's
The fourth episode is a bottle. It's entirely on the Titan.
Yeah,
it's a bottle episode. So yeah, the reason why you had the fourth episode as a bottle episode was to recreate the D. And they've been explicit about that throughout that. It's like it took a lot of money and a lot of painstaking effort just to look at the original blueprints and everything else we had of recreating the Enterprise D bridge.
Yeah, just to make the horseshoe was a bit of a pain in the ass. I know that much, but Yeah, man. When it comes down to it, man, it was almost like a religious experience seeing them step into the D again. I don't know how they all fit into the turbo lift. I've never seen all seven of them be in there, but just to see them step on there, and the fact that they could shoot it effectively, because that was always a complaint going into Generations, that the set of the Enterprise D's bridge was incredibly hard to shoot in a wide aspect ratio, but they pulled it off in this. So maybe we have better cameras now. Maybe they took a new approach when tracking the whole bridge. But it looked great, man. And it was nice to see a bridge with all the lights on. it's crazy how dark these bridges and these ships are. They kind of need to start turning on lights, man. I miss the design of the D, but it was good to see her back in action and kicking ass and seeing everybody take their places, man. But yeah, before I won't go on because I'm sure other things will come up, but I had an incredible time watching this season and seeing everybody come back and seeing this work out when everybody is still with us. So it's an absolute blessing, man. I hope that we get more from this. I know there's a hashtag trending for Star Trek Legacy, and even the producers behind Star Trek says, we hear you. And hopefully something does come of it. I know that we're getting Section 31, a movie based on that sometime in the near future. And that Discovery's ending, so maybe after that all plays out, we'll get word about a follow-up series to this of some kind. And if so, I'm totally on board. But I'll toss it back to you guys and hear what you guys have to say. All right, then.
Hello. Chris, you there?
Hello. Hello.
Okay, so who do you want to throw it to? Me? Or yourself, or how do you want to?
You might as well go next, Neil, because
Chris, that's fine.
Yeah, Chris read off the whole thing, so you should go last.
But okay, go no problem. Yes, Star Trek Picard season 3, The best of the Star Trek Picards. I will say that. Up and down. Gosh. Like episode 4, even though it's a bottle episode to save the money to do in later things, such a good episode. Even the episode after that, such a good episode. You know, I know a lot of people had an issue. It's like, oh my God, they're using a Voyager, or no, they're using a Deep Space Nine villain to be in the, you know, with the TNG cast, and it's like, no, that's not a bad thing, because in the end, the founders were a Starfleet villain. And, you know, less anybody think is, like, the Dominion War was one of the most, like, really horrendous wars that the Federation, Starfleet, has ever really encountered.
Mm-hmm.
So I was excited about that, because I'm like, holy shit, who would... It's like, it kind of makes sense, especially if you watch Deep Space Nine. You're like, wow, the founders are such assholes. And, you know, the fact that they got defeated and all this other crap, it makes kind of sense. And then you're like, oh, fast forward, it's not really the, you know, we got the loop-de-loop. It's like, no, it's not really the founders. It's the Borg. And the Borg has been masterminding this all, but it's not really the Borg. It's the Borg Queen. And it's like, oh, really? Okay. I guess it kind of makes sense, but okay. You know, you get to see cool things. You know, I guess in the end, this whole thing was to give the Star Trek The Next Generation cast the send-off that the original cast got with Star Trek VI, the movie. Which is weird, because I honestly thought that the end of Star Trek The Next Generation, the TV series, is actually pretty good. But it guess when once you factor in the movies, guess that kind of taints it. I don't know.
Yeah, Nemesis was bad. It was horrible.
I mean, I'll always preference in this, in terms of Star Trek, I'm not the biggest TNG person, but I respect it. I understand it. you know, I've learned to like Picard. I mean, I'll be honest, the fake to fake when you thought that, you know, when Raffi and Worf walk in, they're trying to get some things going on, you know, trying to get, find out what's going on with the underworld. And you're like, oh, Worf got killed. No, he didn't. No, he just mastered some like special like Klingon technique where he can, you know, it's like, I was like, oh shit, he actually got killed. I mean, I felt bad about that, but, I mean, there's lots of cool little things in it. In terms of the story, it's like, I guess it makes sense. It's not as bad as the first two seasons. I was entertained. I'm not going to sit there and say I wasn't entertained. Did I feel a little let down that in the end it was the Borg Queen as the final boss? I'm like, eh, okay, I guess. I thought the Borg were done, but, you know, I guess this is their last hurrah. You know, I just felt like when you go up to like season, or when you go up to episode like three and, or episode 3, 4, and 5, and then the way it kind of ended, it just, I think if they paced it better, it might have made a lot more sense, because there's a lot of questions that I'm like, I mean, I just found out before this, and I think, yes, they do mention it in the first episode, but, you know, it's like, why did the Enterprise F get, you know, after this whole thing came down, it's like, why did the Enterprise F get decommissioned? Okay, it was scheduled for decommissioning. But it's like, you kind of need to reinforce that, especially in like episode 10, where it's like you're doing heavy exposition on everything else, but then you're not telling us like what the aftermath of, you know, what happened to Starfleet. And I think also the problem that I have with this season is, the problem I have with a lot of Star Trek is like, especially recent Star Trek, they show like, you know, it's not the ideal organization. They have Section 31. They do some nefarious shit.
Mm-hmm.
And then it's like, well, we do some bad shit and we commit war crimes, but they're not as bad as these people. So we're just going to refocus everything. We're, in the end, we're the heroes. And no matter what horrible shit we did, and the fact that it would fuck up anybody, you know, it's okay. You know, but MVP, I think, in this season, I hate to say it, the poor misguided fucking captain of the Titan A. Captain Shaw.
Captain,
I mean,
Liam Shaw.
The poor fucking bastard. I mean, have we seen a red shirt like this be treated? Have we ever seen a red shirt like this at such a high rank? I mean, he's got 4 pips, dude. He was red shirted hard.
He was. He was definitely disrespected.
And, and it's just like, why? I mean, yes, I, you know, his animosity towards Picard and all this whole thing is like, it was a little bit of retread. You're like, okay, you know. It's like, oh, okay, there's another person that survived Wolf 359. It's like, we didn't think many people survived it, but fuck, there's another guy. And actually, when he talks about that, you're like, holy shit, that's like, it really does that visceral thing, because you think back, it's like, this guy was like a young pup in Starfleet, and the fact that he's even around is the fact that he just, the person in front of him was able to count him in. So, I mean, that was some good stuff there. I mean, it's not, this season's not horrible. It's got a lot of great things in it, but it's also got a lot of weird things in it. And is it full of fan service? Oh my God, it's got fan service dripping on everything. And I guess the maddening thing about it is as well as they write characters, like, actually, to be honest with you, I don't really want to see the Star Trek Legacy show that everybody's talking about. I want Star Trek Riker. Like, they made Riker you know, the fact that they made this such a tortured man in the end, in such a weird way, it's like, almost, it's like season three of Picard is really not about Picard. In a lot of ways, it's about fucking Riker. I mean, the fact in that, what was it, episode three or four, where they you know, they fuck up and the Titan is like aimlessly going towards the gravity well, yeah, about to get crushed. Mm-hmm. I mean, and then you find out like why Riker's the way he is. Like, he told Picard, get the fuck off the bridge.
Yeah.
And you're like, what the fuck? I mean, that's the thing that makes me insane about this, about the season, is you have shit like that and you're like, whoa. You're like, wow, this is insane. But, and then you got just the lazy shit of like, oh, in the end, you know, it's all about the Borg, you know. You know, it wasn't a clear thing in the end. It just, it didn't tie everything, and it just kind of absolved Starfleet of everything. And that was the issue that I had the biggest thing with this whole thing, is just like, it felt like there was like, oh, we just blew up more ships and we'll just rebuild them. And, you know, thousands of people, tens of thousands of innocent fuckers died. No big deal. It's just another day in Starfleet. It seemed kind of weird. I don't think the boomers versus zoomers thing was intentional. I don't think that's an intentional plot thing. I think it's just there because, honestly, I think the writers of this were just fans of the show. They were big fans of the Star Trek The Next Generation, and they just wanted to see their heroes in one last thing. And I think that's really where I kind of go on about, like, that's where I kind of give it its, like, thing. It's like, okay, it's not perfect. A lot of it, after, like, episode five, it doesn't really make a lot of sense. And it's kind of sometimes even counter of what Starfleet would even do. But it's not really made to like tell a deep story. It's just to get the old crew back and to get them in the same things. I mean, when I, Solbro, uh-huh, did you just cream your pants when you saw them go into the Enterprise D? They all took their stations and they're all sitting there. I mean, you must have just had like orgasm. You must have just had just your pants must have been just a wet mess at that point.
Getting to the D, and when they did, it was the end of episode 9, so we really only got a full episode with it.
But still, yeah, I mean, yeah, it's
it felt like a homecoming, as it should. And I didn't have a problem with it being there. It's not to me like this big thing where it's like it came out of the blue. It this doesn't fit, none of that shit. It's just taking an old ship out into battle, and with a ship that's so behind the times, they're in a precarious situation. They get blown out of space.
Right. I mean, they did the Admiral Adama Commander Adama at that point.
Absolutely.
You know, it was, you know, no networks and all this stuff, and I mean, that's limited always weapons. Been the thing. Yeah, limited whatever, and they were able to save the day once again, and you know, everybody.
Hell, you know, the Solstice section.
Beverly became an admiral, of course. You know, Riker, and mm-hmm, and of course, Geordi don't get any promotions, but you know, hey, it's all good in the thing, and it is funny at the end. You know, Jack does, you know, understand that he's a Nepo baby. Uh-huh. I gotta give him for that situation awareness. But yeah, he got it. He's like, hey, I don't think anybody else would do this. You know, and the fact that his whole row was just to, you need to sit on the empty third seat on the Titan, or now the Enterprise G, just to sit next to the captain, the first officer. It's like, okay, whatever. But I mean, it's a sugar high. The show, in terms of the prior two seasons, it's the best season of Star Trek Picard. Did I look forward to the next episode? I did. I had fun.
Yeah.
But I'm not going to sit here and say, like, oh, god damn, this is the changing point of Star Trek. I mean, in terms of all the new Trek that's going on, it's still pretty low on the thing totem pole. I mean,
wow.
I think, yeah, it's pretty low, dude. Seriously.
Man. All right.
It's not Prodigy. It's not Strange New Worlds.
Mm-hmm.
You take out the nostalgia factor.
Yeah.
What else is there in there? Really? I mean, what is the point of all this?
To me, it was these people regrouping and coming to grip with a lot of things that have gone wrong in their lives leading up to this point. It's not these characters didn't exist in a vacuum. They actually went off and did shit. And when they came back, they didn't all gel together at first. You know, there were issues between them. There were unresolved problems. There was the case of a love child. There is, you know, Geordi not thinking about his kids. There's Worf, who's now a pacifist. There's Riker, who's dealing with all sorts of traumatic issues and survivor's guilt over the death of his son. You know, there's a lot going on. It's not just nostalgia bait. There's things going on with these people. They're not the same as we left them.
It's a complete nostalgia.
Not even Data is the same as we left them. Oh my
god. Are you telling me this is not nostalgia bait?
I'm not saying it's all nostalgia bait.
Oh my god. It's all nostalgia bait.
It's not all nostalgia bait. I'll leave it to you.
How many Easter eggs of TNG and every other Star Trek property that's in there?
A ton.
It is nothing but that.
Yeah.
It is nothing but...
But it exists in the universe of Star Trek. You're going to get callbacks to all sorts of things. It's just what it is. And it's the culmination of all these storylines. What were people expecting? They're expecting, oh, new. You got that for the first two seasons. You're not going to get that for this.
But right. This is resolving storylines. But yeah, no, I'm expecting new. Because in the end, it was just various Star Trek Next Generation episodes and other Star Trek movies or snippets from other episodes and movies just factored in. Right. I mean, the rope-a-dope of like, oh, it's the changelings. No, it's the Borg.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, and then it's the same old trope as like, the only people that can save us is the Enterprise. And it's the Enterprise from 100 years ago. And, you know, if you're going to sit there and go like, I mean, it was fun. I'm not saying it's not fun, but if you're looking at like a coherent story and something that really goes to the lore.
Yeah.
And the fact that, you know, the biggest thing is these people are 30 years from what they were prior. But in the end, it ended up being just, this is what they did back 30 years ago. And it's like, no, they changed. I mean, they changed. And I don't know. I mean, Chris, go ahead. I yield to you at this point. So
You're way more negative on this season than I would have expected.
Yes, same here.
Kind of sounds like you really didn't enjoy it that much.
No, I had fun with it, but in terms of like, I'll be honest with you. I think from episode 4 when we saw, I like the section 31. You know, I like that thing of Star. I like the fact that Starfleet is flawed. And I like it that, you know, they say what they want to say, but they're still just as bad as everybody else. And they still want to be number one. And they're going to do, if somebody gets in a fight with them, they're going to do what they need to do. And I felt from about episode 5 on, it was just the same old stuff. And it was just a nostalgia train. So, I don't know. I guess I was expecting more. Didn't mean I didn't enjoy it. I don't want people to think that I didn't enjoy it, but, you know. So, go ahead, Chris.
I'm going to have to disagree with you and back up Sober on saying that it was entirely nostalgia bait. It's not. Is there tons of nostalgia? Sure. There's just as much references and nostalgia in Prodigy and Lower Decks. Yeah. So I don't see that this show, the season, is particularly more out of hand in those regards. And, you know, it's showing us how these people have changed over the last 20 years. Remember, we hadn't seen at least half of this crew since Nemesis over 20 years ago, yep, which was a piece of shit movie.
Yeah. So bad.
It is. It was a terrible place to leave things off. And, you know, until this show was announced, I thought for so long, like, oh man, it sucks that like original series got to have a send-off movie that wrapped mm-hmm. everything up, and next gen is fucking Nemesis.
Yeah.
So the fact that this show has come along and erased the taint of Nemesis, and now Nemesis is just a bump along the road rather than a final destination, is all that this series needed to do.
Yeah, thank you.
Even if it had just been one season. That's all it needed to do, is erase the stink of Nemesis.
That's the only point of it. It's just the erase the stink of Nemesis. I mean, if you're looking at that, then yeah, it achieves, and I'm with you on that. I completely get you on that. But, and you can go ahead. We'll debate it after that.
I really think that you're kind of just mischaracterizing the season, that it's just a nostalgia train, when it's really shown growth of these characters, the ways that they came apart. Like, you know, the revelation that Crusher got pregnant and then ghosted Picard and everyone for 20 years and robbed him of the opportunity to get to be a parent and raise his son. Like, she did him real dirty.
Yeah. It's
oh yeah.
It's not good.
That's not nostalgia mining. That's showing that, you know, time has passed for these characters and their relationships have changed.
She did the Carol Marcus, but even worse than Carol Marcus, because
Kirk knew about at least his son.
Because Kirk knew about the son, but at least Picard didn't know about it. Like, yeah, I mean, yeah.
Like, yeah, did Picard have a complicated relationship with kids? Yes, sure. But he'd also lightened up by the time that she got knocked up, but you know, she robbed him of the opportunity to embrace the change and to embrace parenthood, and you know, that's a pretty terrible thing to do. So even if the reasoning sound justified, like, yeah, at the end of the day, I can see why she didn't want to have him in Picard's life, because of all the
danger
attempts on his life and all the danger, but just basically disappear practically in the middle of the night, not tell him, hey, you've got a kid. It's pretty shitty.
And on top of that, a lot of it, they lived on the same planet for a good deal of it. He studied in school in London, which is like a stone's throw away from France, where Picard lives. So at any time that she could arrange the meeting between them, but that never happened. So, but
even Jean-Luc says that. He's like, that was one of the more powerful things that he said the whole season. It's like, how do you get to sit there and say that I couldn't change? Like, you're basing this on like what you think is going to happen, but you can't tell me. So how do you know how I'm going to react if you don't give me the opportunity to react?
Also, you know, she's like, oh, I didn't tell him to avoid you or anything. And I encourage him. It's like, okay, but his entire life has been premised on the fact that you don't want his father to know that he exists. That's not exactly a ringing endorsement, Beverly.
Yeah. Yeah, she looks like shit in that. Yeah.
Which makes it all the more heartbreaking when you see the flashback of Picard at the Earth 10 forward talking to all those cadets. And Jack is there, and Picard says, Starfleet's the only family I ever needed.
What a great scene, man. It's fucked up. But the realization is the best part about all of that. But go ahead.
And that's the greatest thing about this. I think in terms of, I mean, I'll let Chris finish, but I think in terms of where I think in terms of developing characters, this is an incredible show. In terms of an overall story, not so much. Like, I will give you guys all of that, because I agree everything what you're saying. Go ahead, Chris.
You know, other character relationships, Riker and Troy, the fact that, you know, they were not as good as they seemed in season one, that they still are both depressed about the death of their son. And not only that, but that Troy has been using her powers to, like,
to diminish Riker's
diminish pain. Riker's grief, which he feels is a big violation. It's like, yeah, that is. That's not a cool thing to do.
No.
That crosses a huge ethical line. And, you know, it gave me shades of, you know, even though Final Frontier is a terrible movie, you know, that one scene with McCoy's father, and after that, when Kirk says to Cybok, you know, I don't want to forget my pain. I need my pain.
Yeah, it kind of helps define you.
Very much felt like what Riker was arguing to Troy.
Yeah.
You know, seeing Geordi, the fact that, hey, we finally made it so that Geordi's not some pervy, creepo, loser, incel.
Yeah, they really did LeVar Burton dirty with that in the show.
Which he was never happy about, and, you know, they repaired that by giving him two daughters, one of whom is played by his actual daughter, Mika Burton.
Correct.
But, of course, the question they never quite address is, who the hell is their mother? Is it Leah Brahms? Is it just Lee? Can we get at least an answer for that? Who the hell is it?
I really hope it's not Leah Brahms. I hope it's someone else. Because last we checked, she was married. Although All Good Things did kind of a hint that that he would eventually get with her and have three kids. But things may have played out a little differently. I mean, he had two of the kids in the past.
In Nemesis, in the script, they never filmed this because the actress wasn't available.
Oh.
In Nemesis, she was divorced by then and was dating Geordi and was his plus one to the Riker-Troy wedding.
Yo, stop.
Oh, really?
I had no idea.
But they were not able to get the actress, so they had him just sitting next to Guinan.
Well, they need to make sure that it, if they did get together, that it happened because she wanted it to. And that he wasn't, like, studying up. He wasn't, like, the Geordi of old, basically. That, you know, it happened naturally. I'm
just open showed to up like, hey, so you're divorced, huh? What a coincidence. I'm single, too.
I was just reading the divorce papers. Fucked up. Oh, go ahead, sorry.
You know, we got to mention this new version of Data.
Yes.
Which I know a lot of people say is just a cop-out because he already died in Nemesis, and then they killed him again in Picard, and... You know, but this version of Data became something different by absorbing Lore and having E4 and Lol in him. And this this Data got to experience what the original Data wanted but couldn't, because I always felt the emotion chip in Generations was a kind, it really hurt the character of Data. And you can see that in the fact that in the subsequent movies, he can turn off the emotion chip, or remove it entirely. And they walked away from it almost as soon as they introduced it, because I think they realized how badly they fucked up.
Yeah.
That it was just a cheap way to make Data different, but it was robbing him of the successful completion of the journey he'd been on his own without an emotion chip.
Yeah.
So the fact that this version of Data, which has some of those rough edges of Lore in him, gets to experience life in a golem body and have aging and have, you know, feelings that are real and not a chip. Like, you know, he got to become, Pinocchio became a real boy.
Yes. Thank you. Man, it's such a delight to see.
I actually love that scene. I mean, you knew he was going to survive. I mean, when they do the okie doke of like, oh, Data's going to go into this like weird virtual world and he's going to be sitting there with Lore and all this other stuff, but and you knew he was going to prevail at the end, and it was so predictable, but it was good though. I thought the way they kind of did it, and it's like, it wasn't cheap. It's like, I give you all these things that I've experienced, Lore, and he's like, oh, I'll take them. Blah, 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 blah. It's like, why are you crying? Well, because you'll never experience what I experienced. And it's like, that was cool. I thought that was, outside of like some of the, I think outside of like that whole like episode 4 of where you got like the whole thing with like Riker, you know, talking with Picard about, you know, you told me to do this and now we're going down this gravity well and this is why I'm such a angry asshole and stuff like that. I mean, that was the good stuff. And that is the one thing I will say about this show at all is like, and I know people are like, oh, you fucking hate it. It's like, character wise, they really made the characters great. It's just, I wasn't always on the overall story, but okay. Go ahead, Chris.
I will say that I thought that, you know, the drama at the end of the third episode between Picard and Riker, it didn't work. I know that they were talking it up as forced, like, it's going to be like, it's a Crimson Tide moment, but it really just, to me, did not work because, you know, it's not like he had any choice but to fight, and they didn't know about the portal weapons, so it's like, it's not like Picard forced them to do anything. They did what they had to do because they had no other options, and then even that didn't even work. So I don't know where the hell Riker was coming from with this, oh, get off the bridge, you've killed us all. Like, it just felt like some fake tension to end the episode on, and it just didn't work at all.
It felt
quite forced.
I think in some ways it was just highlighting the fact that Riker was just so fucked up. And he was just, I think that was the thing I got from it, was like, he's just, and
also
so
what
up.
Picard called him out, said like, you know, you're just acting all weird because, you know, your kid died, and Riker's like, oh, how dare you? And then literally the next episode, he's like,
yeah,
you were right.
That to me is the part that didn't work. Daddy. The part that didn't work is that they resolved it so quickly. If it took a little bit more time, like if it hung in the air for like a whole episode and then something came up and they both came to each other and worked out their differences, then I would accept it, because I do get that that's a trigger for Riker. The fact that he, you know, feels guilt over the death of his son, and that was the wrong thing to say to him in that time, although John Luke didn't really have much headroom for kind of coaxing him into seeing it his way. He had to kind of snap him out of his trauma, and it just didn't work out as well as it could. Ultimately, John Luke was right, but at the end of the day, you know, Riker had to go through what he went through. I just wish he had resolved it a little bit. It took a little bit more time for that to resolve.
The thing I got from it with Riker was he was always the cocksure guy.
Yeah.
On what he felt, what he was, you know, in the movies and the TV show. And then you get this broken Riker who's like, the kid's done. And I think his kid died. And I think what he was weirded about was all these kids are around him on the Titan.
Mm-hmm.
And especially when he finds out that one of them is Geordi's kid. And I think that's where I was like, where he was just like, I don't know what the fuck to do anymore. Like, you know, and you, I'm going to listen to you because I respect the shit out of you, Jean-Luc. But because I thought you were going to tell us to do something and it would end up being a great thing.
Mm-hmm.
And it didn't, fuck you. Like, that was, because he's just been like a broken man throughout the whole series of Picard, he's been a broken man, but especially in season 3, he's just a completely broken shithead. Like, and I love Riker, but I mean, he's just a broken, and you understand it. You understand what it is.
It's the most depth we've ever had out of that character, too. When it comes down to it,
you understand at the end where he's sitting there with Deanna, it's like, we got to go back to that planet. She's like, I fucking hate that planet. He's like, I fucking hated it too. And it's like, I thought you liked it. No, I fucking hated it. It's like,
it's the planet of space hipsters.
Yeah, I mean, that's cool. That's cool. But go ahead, Chris. Sorry, I jump in your shit.
Well, you keep jumping in so much that I've completely lost my train of thought, so thanks a lot.
We're talking about Riker and Picard blowing up on each other. I think that's the last thing we spoke about.
Yeah, the character relationships, they all work. Seeing everybody come back together again, despite where life has taken them, it all worked. I did like this new version of Data. Yes, it was an excuse to have Brent Spiner in the third season, but you know, it didn't feel like a cop out resurrection. Like it was earned because you know, it's not even like Spock, where you know the next movie was all about bringing Spock back, and then they all get him back and they continue their adventures, or you know, Into Dumbness, where Kirk is dead for 5 minutes. You know, they went 20 years with him dead.
Yeah,
yeah.
You know, there was a price paid, and you see that in the scene where Geordi's just so happy to have his friend back, and he talks about how Data's death broke him, and you know, everybody had to pay the price of losing Data, and then got him back. It's not like it was a quick little turnaround.
Absolutely.
Wasn't a quick anime resurrection.
Ah!
So I have no problem with that. Yeah, as far as the plot of the Changelings and Borg, you know, we needed to have the actual Borg one more time, because we never found out to what extent the Borg were even still a thing after what Janeway did to them in the series finale of Voyager. And as we see, they're quite messed up.
Yeah, I mean,
we saw a little hint of that in Prodigy.
Yeah, because in season one, we got the X-Bees. In season two, we got an alternate version of the Borg leading up to Jurati, and then that she and her Borgati go to, I don't know if it's a parallel dimension or some other faraway place in space. And then finally, we get the resolution of not only Picard and the Borg Queen, but also the aftermath of Voyager. And it's like, it was really cool to see those tie in into this finale as well. So to me, I thought it was really cool.
And I thought that, you know, the villainous plan here, it makes sense, because the Borg has tried, they've tried the direct approach multiple times on Next Gen and Voyager, and they failed each time. So, you know, they came up with a different plan, and, you know, for a little bit it actually worked, and they actually assimilated a huge amount of Starfleet, and you know, they almost pulled it off. So I think that vindicates what they were trying to do, of doing this sneaky approach, and they were only able to do what they did because of the help from these changelings, which we definitely need to make note of, are different from the Founders, because we find out that Vadic and these other changelings were ones that Starfleet somehow captured and experimented on and tortured to make the virus that was killing the Founders in Deep Space Nine.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
And this made their physiology different, and you know, gives them, especially Vadic, sufficient motive for wanting to get revenge. So, you know, it's a classic move of two villains who can't defeat the heroes separately deciding, hey, why don't we join up together and maybe we can do a better job together than we do apart. And it works.
Yeah.
It does work.
Yeah, they,
because, you know, they killed, I mean, think of how many people were killed on all of those starships from, you know, the senior crew who were not assimilated. Think about all those people on
Starbase.
The Starbase who were killed when it blew up. You know, plus the trauma they've inflicted upon all of these young Starfleet officers of having been assimilated. So now, instead of just Picard and Seven feeling this trauma, you have tens of thousands of people who feel the same way too.
You got President Chekhov talking about the fact that that is spread onto Earth, and that the young people of Earth are also revolting because of the Borg Order 66. So
that's not what he said.
Oh,
about the people in Starfleet turning. He wasn't talking about it getting on Earth. That's not at all what he was saying.
Well, when he was talking to, when he was addressing the public, I thought he had mentioned that.
No, he sent out
spread the Earth, and even his.
He was talking about the attack on Earth.
On Earth, by sending a warning.
Oh, because his aide was telling people not to.
Okay. He was telling people not to come to Earth.
Gosh,
he was saying, "Don't come to Earth. Mm-hmm. There's problems going on. Our people, our young officers are revolting. Stay away."
Gotcha. All right.
And then he said something that Spock basically said.
Yeah.
In one of the episodes. So, or one of the movies, actually. I think it was the fourth movie or whatever.
But, yeah, he says a few things that the president of Earth in movie 4 also said, too.
That's what his whole situation was on that. So, I mean, he did what every other... Federation president did when there was something don't come here, don't stay away, oh the whale probe's here, stay away, you know. I mean, it was kind of the same situation.
Endless possibilities, gentlemen. But back to you, Chris.
There's always endless possibilities. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Yeah, there's some things for me that didn't work as well, like we've already mentioned, you know, the networked fleet. Yeah.
Why
is Starfleet so hell-bent? It's like Solbro said, there literally was an episode about this in the original series with Richard Daystrom in the 60s. Like, come on.
No, there was a whole thing in this show about the thing about artificial intelligence and going against anything that was robotic. Season 1 of Picard. Yeah. It's like, why would you even do this? Like, that I don't even understand. That's the thing that drove me crazy about it. I'm like, wait, okay, I get this. I'm against robots too, and I guess but Starfleet's always been pretty apprehensive about it. And you would think, how many times did they fight the Borg? Why would you do any? Because, I mean, I think always the weird thing about the whole Borg stuff is like, the one thing they never really go into about the Borg is if realistically the Borg would infiltrate the Starfleet, the systems of the ship. Mm-hmm. I mean, if Spock's able to go to the command code and override the Reliance, you know, systems by like what, a 5-digit code, the freaking Borg could figure it out.
They did note the irony of someone like Shelby, talking up, fleet formation mode as a good thing when it's so obviously a Borg type thing, like,
right? And she was like the number one.
I guess she lost the plot as she climbed the ladder up to Admiral.
Yeah.
Well, no, that was the whole Picard thing. It was like anybody that ever questioned Picard or Riker died in this in season.
Yeah,
3.
Right. Like, Roe and Shelby. Yeah.
Roe and Shelby. It's like. Who else? I mean, I'm surprised Jellicoe didn't.
Yeah, no doubt. I was surprised
they didn't break him out. Like, Admiral Jellicoe got just fucking murked. And it's like, I mean, it's stupid things like that. And I get it. And, I hate the internet. And the internet, it's there for me to order shit. But then I also hate the subset of the internet where they do this nitpicky. But then I'm like reading this, like, you know what? That is some dumbass shit. It's like all the people that fucking ever questioned Picard or Riker got killed. I mean, I felt bad for Admiral Shelby because it's like, damn, she finally sat there and told, you know, she fulfilled her wish that she told Riker in TNG. Is like, one day I'll be in this ship. It's like you're in an Enterprise, not the D, because we've blown up the other ones because of, you know, Picard and Riker are fucking reckless as shit, but, you know, he's getting this one, and it's like, what the fuck? I mean, that was hilarious, so, yeah.
Yeah, the networking of ships, it's like,
can
we just stop with this, please?
Yes, like, please!
Can we not do this storyline again? Also, I felt kind of robbed that they mentioned Janeway so many times throughout the season. Never showed up. Unfortunately, that was a budgetary thing. They did plan having Janeway. The original script called for Admiral Janeway and Captain Harry Kim to be the ones...
You finally got promoted?
Yes.
Oh,
to
my
be the
God.
Ones to give Seven her promotion.
That's
and,
upsetting.
I wish they could have done that because it would have been
Why?
So thematically... Oh. Relevant okay. for Janeway to be the one to give Seven that promotion.
Yeah. Okay. Man. Straight talk here. I'm borrowing the fucking bus. Chris. It's a streaming show. What's the budgetary restrictions on this? Seriously.
Apparently, they had a very tight budget on this season, and
but for what? They... Because if they're filming this shit, why can't they put it in there? Like. What? That's the thing I'm not understanding. Like
they probably looked at the ratings of season one and they said we only can allocate this much for what ratings we're going to expect to get.
Because
this could have dropped like a dud and it didn't.
It's a streaming show. Like I'm not I'm not a smart guy when it comes to Hollywood, but I'm just not understanding the fact that you would go through the whole thing of producing something.
Mm-hmm.
You have it there. Even if you put the bullshit like substandard CGI on it, whatever. But if it's integral and this is a fucking show of like nostalgia train, why are you sitting there saying, well, we couldn't do this in our own, the own streaming service that we control, they control it. Why couldn't they put it in there?
Look, like, they had the budget they did. Why they could or could not do it, it doesn't matter.
Answer, Mr. Paramount Plus, answer me that. Like, I'm just trying to understand that. Like, I don't know. I'm a simple man. I'm just trying to understand if you control everything,
mm-hmm.
how can't you put that in there? Like, would it be, you know, earth shattering and would it make the world, you know, I don't know.
But I don't know. You got a bunch of penny pinchers at all of these studios, so... It is what it is.
Okay.
They wanted to do it. They couldn't. There's really no point debating why they could or couldn't. They just couldn't. So they also had wanted to have scene of Data meeting Soji, which also would have been really great to see.
Yeah,
it would have just
cool.
brought everything full circle from season one, but couldn't swing that either. So that had to hit the cutting room floor and they didn't film that. I also felt that we're doing this epilogue and you're not even going to mention or show Laris.
Yeah, yeah.
Dude. Yeah, right.
What happened with her?
Oof.
Like, did Picard just ghost her and it's like, that's the...
He did. Yeah.
That's the end of the story? Like, sorry, I'm going to hang out with my old friend. See you later.
They couldn't even film like a video call between... Him and her, like
he just mentioned that he's gonna go meet her after the poker game. Anything,
yeah, man, anything, like, anything.
Hey.
I love Laris. I'm so sad that.
Hey, Laris, I gotta talk to you about this, Sean Luke. yeah,
dude, John Litter.
Found out that I got a son. Remember I told you about Beverly? I worked with her for a while, and like you know, like one of the last nights that we were working together, we kind of got together and she had a son and he's like the savior of the universe. You probably saw that stuff about the fleet formation things in Frontier Day. Yeah, we stopped that and it was because of my son and, you know, it's all cool. You know, it's good, but, you know, I'm going to kind of stay with them. Just make sure you take number one out every night.
Number one.
So he doesn't crap in my room. So I'm reacting the scene you didn't see.
Wow.
Engage.
Well.
Yeah, that kind of sucks. I feel bad for her.
Resolution for Laris, damn it.
But she's actually hotter than Beverly, so, and she's younger too. So.
Damn it.
And if I was John Luke, that's the thing I'd be like, all right, you know, all right, Admiral Crusher, you can do your stuff, and Jack, your Nepo baby, but I'm gonna get me some, give me some Romulan here, so yeah, it's good stuff. So, yeah, interspecies. So there you go.
Good times.
Yeah, I was not a fan of those deletions because, you know, it would have added stuff. And I'm still happy with the epilogue that we got of Seven coming into her own and becoming captain of the Enterprise, even though many fanboys are pissed off about the Enterprise F getting retired and the Titan getting rebranded as the G, but whatever.
Chris, what do you think she said as her cue to the going to warp speed?
Probably something like, "Warp will now commence."
I think she said "proceed" because she said that a little.
That
bit.
That was something that she did say a lot on Voyager.
Yeah.
Whatever she said, I'm sure had to be better than what Spock says in Strange New Worlds.
Oh, but, Lord.
Yeah, something else I want to mention that I really appreciated was the wrap-up of Raffi's storyline and the role that Worf played in that of leaking all this stuff to make sure that her husband and son find out, hey, she's not actually a crazy person, and she did all this stuff to, like, save Earth, and, you know, she did that twice, so, you know, maybe give her another chance, and they do, so... You know, I'm glad that they got to have that culmination to her journey, and I really enjoyed the like senpai kohai relationship between her and Worf this whole season.
Yo, ditto.
Actually, I'd have to say that was like the surprise, like part of this season was the fact that like they got together and it was just seemed so seamless. I mean, the fact that I actually wish they had more screen time together.
Yeah, same here.
I mean, like I said, I will say this on, you know, I know we're getting the Section 31 movie and we get Emperor Jojo and or whatever she is at this point, but I still would like to see, I still think the better spinoff from this is Section 31 with Worf. Like, I honestly, Worf and Raffi, that's what I want to see. I mean, it's cool if they do this whole Star Trek Legacy thing with Seven and the Enterprise G and all this stuff and, you know, Nepa Baby Jack and all that, but we kind of seen that before. I honestly want Worf outside of him just falling asleep every so often.
Hey, what matters to me when it comes to that spinoff is if Terry's going to helm the show. Because if he's going to helm the show, I know story-wise it's going to be in good hands.
Character wise, it'll be good hands. Yeah. I don't know about story wise.
Oh, that'll give us two shows with Enterprises as the main ship. If that's the case, running concurrently.
I don't know that.
Which I'm fine with. I don't have a problem with that. They're in two different time periods, so I'll let it rock if that turns out to be the case. So we'll see. We'll see.
Probably time to start wrapping this up.
That's true. Where was that? 12:30, man. So ratings, guys. Who wants to go first? Yo, Neil, you wanna?
No, bro.
Oh, you want me to go? All right then. All right.
Yeah, I already know my rating, but you go ahead.
I thoroughly enjoyed this season. It had a few hiccups and some things that we could question about, but overall, this is easily the best season of Picard. I wouldn't say it's my number one. Show out of new tracks, but it's up there. It's probably in my top three, to be honest. When it comes to this season alone, and it makes for a great epilogue season for TNG, especially for those who have watched TNG all the way through and may have not seen all the other Trek. You can jump into this show. I highly encourage you do that if you want to jump on Paramount Plus. Do so. But my rating is 4.5. Visible comm badges out of 5. I don't know if you noticed, but at the end of after the year jump, they changed the color of the comm badges from like gunmetal gray to the base of them. They made them gold, so you can actually see them. So, they contrast with the uniforms, which is what I was hoping to see leading into this season. But they added it at the end, so I thought that was cool. But yeah, 4.5 visible comm badges out of 5. Who's next? All right, then.
I'm gonna say, you know, in reflection, I probably would go back and lower my review of my rating of season 2.
Yeah.
But that's you know, in the distant past. So for season 3, I will give it 4.5 Ooh. No-show Janeway's out of 5.
Nicely done. Damn. No-show Janeway's, man. She busy with the the Protostar gang, man.
Yeah, 20 years ago. They're still, you know, they should all be old by now.
They should be.
Yeah, that's true. They would be all old at this point. Yeah. They're not kids anymore.
No doubt. No doubt.
But Neil. All right. Wow.
Oh, yeah, man. Give us your 2.
No, not a 2. Not a 2. Not as high as you guys, but not a 2.
2 space babies out of 5. Let's go.
No. You didn't listen to anything I was saying.
I'm kidding, of course, but go ahead. Sorry.
Rich is funny because I will say this. In terms of character development, mm-hmm. I think this is one of the better Star Trek shows there is. Honestly, I mean, mm-hmm. and you guys are right. You come back and you see all the crap that these people went through.
Oh yeah.
But overall, when it came to kind of the story, the big bad, and some of the stuff that's just like, wait a second, why the fuck are we doing this? I just have to say, 3.5. Q's not dead. Out of 5, because yeah. That motherfucker ain't dead. Oh. Or, what is that?
He's Schrodinger's cue, man. He's dead and alive at the same time.
We didn't even talk about that. The mid-credits thing is like, supposedly Q died in season 2. And I get it. He's an omnipresent spirit and all this other stuff. And it's like, wait, what the fuck is this? Like, that's the thing that drove me crazy about this season is like, dumb crap like that.
It's I'll allow it.
You're smart shit, and then it's like, wait, Q's not dead. Yeah. Jack Crusher, I know you're a Nepo baby, but, you know, I'm a Nepo baby myself. I'm just going to kind of sit here and fuck with you.
It's easily the best dressed Q I've ever seen. He was for five seconds of footage. I've never seen him.
He was a good.
With that kind of drip on ever, man. That they look good. Yo, shout out to John Delance. Good shit.
You know, and once again, this comes back to the old point of like, we can put Q in. Why can't we have these other things? Why can't we just show like a blurry screenshot of Admiral Janeway? I heard, and I don't know, Chris. I know you follow this stuff more, but. I heard the other thing about it was, and this is the thing going on the internet, was that Janeway's more of a prodigy thing. Like, they're doing the whole, like, Marvel excuse, like, oh, no, the Kingpin's more of, like, a Spider-Man villain, so you're not going to see him in Daredevil and stuff like that. That was the other thing I heard, is like, you know, Janeway's kind of like, you know, she's with Prodigy, so we really can't. I don't know how true that is, but
I really don't believe that at all, because, you know, it just sounds like it's fan
so stupid
nonsense, yeah. Not based on anything. But in the case of John Delancey popping up, it was something that he did on his last day of shooting for season 2. They just threw that costume on him, and they filmed that whole scene in under 20 minutes.
I remember hearing about it, actually. When they were filming it, he had mentioned it casually in an interview that he was filming a scene for season 3. And I was like, when is it going to happen? And of course, they save it for the tag. So I was like, oh, that works.
So before we go, I just want, you know, the internet buzz is Star Trek Legacy. Everybody's got their own pictures. There's all these things, and the internet's got mapped out the first like 5 episodes of the show and things like that. Are you guys cool with that, or do you want something else?
Personally, I mean, I would honestly much rather have Legacy over Starfleet Academy.
Yes, the same.
Because I don't care about the concept of this. I've never cared much for the concept. Maybe they'll do a good job.
What's the concept of Starfleet Academy again? Just kids going through the academy?
Just young punks going through the academy, like a college CW young people show. Like, it just, and the idea's never interested me.
And set during the time of Discovery, so more than likely it's going to be following.
Allegedly.
So they haven't confirmed that.
Well,
okay.
I think you could do it at any time, actually.
Oh, yeah, I would love to see him do it at an earlier time, but
The teaser that they put out said that Starfleet Academy is accepting new students for the first time in a century, which yeah. makes it sound like it's Discovery era.
Sounds like that, yeah. I will say this, if they move forward with Legacy, which is what I want them to do, I would like them to stick with the crew they have now, and it would be a kind of a cool way to kind of have guest appearances from people from other Star Trek series showing here, including reoccurring appearances from, like, you know, Geordi, because Geordi's daughter's going to be in it, so he might show up from time to time, or Data, or whoever, depending on what they're dealing with, you can have different people show up. So it's kind of a way of, like, reintroducing a lot of characters from previous Star Treks back into the series. Hell, we could visit DS9 as on one of the episodes. So I would love Legacy to become a thing and pick up right where it left off. That'd be really
well,
cool.
If there's Legacy, the only person I want to see is Captain Harry Kim.
There you go. I
that
do too.
Motherfucker.
Absolutely.
He went 7 years without getting a fucking promotion. How did he get fast tracked out at that point? It's like, I mean, so that would be the question. It's like, after the Voyager crew came back, did they all get, like, at least two promotions? Like, you know, it's like, oh, you did all this great shit for Starfleet, you get two promotions, or what happens there?
But you would hope, but
I would hope, actually, yeah. Because that poor motherfucker did not get, yeah, he was shitted on the whole time.
Harry saved the ship numerous times. He deserves at least 3-rank promotion, man. Fuck it. But
he never got promoted, he never got ass, he never got anything. So
God,
it's like,
damn.
Yeah, poor guy, man.
That's a tough record, man. It's a tough record.
He had the toughest of records. So, but anything else?
No, I'm gonna keep it short. MHQ.net, guys, go visit. All the links you need to find are there, man. Go there, hit the hit your favorites button, and check often. And shout out to Chris for making it such a fantastic website, man. And that's it for me, man. Let's do this.
Chris, anything with MHQ.net before we leave, or?
No.
Things are coming. All right. Well, thank you, everybody. And thank you for joining us for episode 274 of Gundam MHQ. And we'll be back in a few weeks with some more mecha or mecha-related action. Thank you.
Very stylish girl. How do I look? I find you guilty of harassment. And might I add, if you're hungry, go to a restaurant for criminy's sake or a grocery store, but leave that poor bird alone.